What is semi-supervised learning? Well, let me give you an example. So consider building an AI model that can classify pictures of cats and dogs. If you give the model a picture of an animal, it will tell you if that picture shows a cat or if it shows a dog. Now, we can build a model like that using a process called supervised learning, not semi, just supervised learning. Now, this involves training the model on a data set. And this data set has images where they are labeled, and those images are labeled as either cat or dog. So, for instance, we might have 100 images, and half of them are labeled as cat, and the other half of them are labeled as dog. Now, we also have here an AI model that is going to do the work here. And the model learns from these labeled examples by identifying patterns and features that differentiate these animals. So perhaps things like ear shape, because they're generally more pointy for cats, or body structure, which are generally more bulky for dogs. Then during training, the model makes predictions, evaluates the accuracy of the predictions through something called a loss function, which says, was I right? Was it really a cat or a dog? And it makes adjustments using techniques such as gradient descent that update the model weights to improve future predictions. Now, that's all well and good, but as we've established, supervised learning needs a labeled data set. This data set here is full of labels, and those form the ground truth from which the model trains. Now, when we think about what a label actually is, it could be as simple as a classification label. So that just says that, yeah, this picture contains a cat, and yeah, this picture contains a dog. But it could also be something a bit more complicated as well, such as an image segmentation label. And that assigns labels to individual pixel boundaries in an image, indicating precisely where in the image the object can be found. Now, this is all manual work that somebody has to perform. And I don't know about you, but going through a data set of hundreds of images and pets and then like designing and assigning labels to them, it's not my idea of a good time. Labeling images of cats and dogs is time-consuming and tedious, but what about more specialized use cases like genetic sequencing or protein classification? That sort of data annotation is not only extremely time-consuming, but it also requires a very specific domain expertise. There are just fewer people that can do it. So enter the world of semi-supervised learning to help us out. Semi-supervised learning offers a way to extract benefit from a scarce amount of labeled data while making use of relatively abundant unlabeled data. Now, before we get into the how, as in how semi-supervised learning works, let's first address the why. Why not just build your model using whatever labeled data is currently available? Well, the answer to that is that using a limited amount of labeled data introduces the possibility of something called overfitting. This happens when the model performs well on the training data set, but it struggles to generalize to new unseen images. So, for instance, suppose that in the training data set, most of the images are the cats that are taken indoors. And most of the images of dogs, those are taken outdoors. Well, the model might mistakenly learn to associate outdoor settings with dogs rather than focusing on more meaningful features. And as a result, it could incorrectly classify any image that's outdoors as being a dog, even if it contains a cat. In general, the solution to overfitting is to increase the size of the training data set. And that is where semi-supervised learning comes in. By incorporating unlabeled data into the training process, we can effectively expand our data set. So, for example, instead of just training on a model that contains 100 labeled examples, we can also add in some unlabeled examples as well. So maybe we could add in 1,000 unlabeled examples into this data set as well. That gives the model more context to learn from without requiring additional labeled data. So that's the why. Now let's get into the how. Now there are many semi-supervised learning techniques. Let's just narrow down our focus to four of them. So first up is something called the wrapper method. So what is the wrapper method? Well, here's what it does. We start with the base model trained on a labeled data set. And then we use this train model to predict labels for the unlabeled data set. That's images that contain, let's say, cats and dogs, but the individual images do not specify an actual label. Now, those predicted labels, they have a name. They are called pseudo labels. So a pseudo label is a label assigned by this method. And they are typically probabilistic rather than deterministic, meaning that the pseudo label, it comes with a probability of how confident the model is in its labeling. So it might say, for example, for a given label, there's an 85% chance that this one is a dog, for example. Now, pseudo labels with high confidence are then combined with the original labeled data set, and then they're treated as if they were actual ground truth labels. Now, the model is retrained on this new data set, which is, of course, now a bit larger, and that includes both the labeled and the pseudo labeled data. And this process can be repeated iteratively, with each iteration improving the quality of the pseudo labels as the model becomes better at distinguishing between the images. So that's the wrapper method. Now, another approach is called unsupervised pre-processing. Now, that uses a feature called an autoencoder. Now, what the autoencoder does is it learns to represent each image in a more compact and meaningful way by capturing essential features, so things like edges and shapes and textures. And when that's applied to the unlabeled images, it extracts these key features, which are then used to train a supervised model more effectively. Therefore, it's helping it better generalize even with limited labeled data. Another method that is commonly used relates to clustering. So clustering-based methods. Now, these apply the cluster assumption, which is essentially that similar data points are likely to belong to the same class. So a clustering algorithm, something like k-means, can group all data points, both labeled and unlabeled, into clusters based on their similarity. So for example, if we do that here, if we've got a cluster and we've got some labeled examples that kind of fall here on the matrix, and then we have some unlabeled examples which fall around here as well, well, we can pseudo-label the unlabeled images in that cluster as well. So if the labeled images were cats, we could say that those unlabeled ones that fall in the same area are cats as well. And then finally, the method we want to talk about here is called active learning. Now, what active learning does is brings humans into the loop. So samples with low confidence level pseudo labels, meaning the model wasn't really sure how to classify them, they can be referred to human annotators for labeling. So human labelers are only working on images that the model is unable to reliably classify itself. Now, there are other semi-supervised learning techniques as well, but the key here is that they can be combined. So for example, we could start here with unsupervised pre-processing, and that can be used to first extract meaningful features from the unlabeled dataset, which gives us a solid foundation for more accurate clustering-based methods that we can then use. Now, these clusters of pseudo-labeled data can then be incorporated into the wrapper method up here, improving the model with each retraining cycle. And then meanwhile, we would then rely on active learning to take the most ambiguous or the most low confidence samples and ensure that human effort is focused where it's most needed. So that is semi-supervised learning, a method to incorporate unlabeled data into the model training alongside labeled examples, creating a better fitting model. Just like raising a cat or a dog, it needs a little bit of structure, a little bit of freedom, and a whole lot of learning along the way.